with neurological events and age. And they have differentiated into type 1 and type 2 deficits, wherein type 1 deficit is basically focal injuries, coma or stupor at the time of discharge. And type 2 is deterioration in intellectual functions, memory deficits or seizures. So as we can see, in younger age group, that is less than 40, the incidence is almost zero. And as the decades increase steadily. So by the time it reaches around 60, the incidence is around 2%, which is the most common population which undergoes CABG. And as the age further increases, the incidence almost doubles. So to almost 4 to 6% by around 70 to 80, and more than 80 is roughly around 8%. Now coming to the risk factors, in the preoperative period when a patient comes to us, if the patient has risk factors like which is not modifiable, like prior history of stroke or transient ischemic attack, significant atherosclerotic changes, especially in the proximal ascending aorta or the carotid or intracranial cerebral arteries, advanced age, these things are non-modifiable. Again, comorbidities like diabetes, renal failure, peripheral artery disease, hypertension, a pre-op history of atrial fibrillation or ongoing atrial fibrillation, female gender, recent myocardial infarctions and unstable angina, moderate to severe left ventricular dysfunction. Now coming to the intraoperative period, again, episodes of severe hypotension, manipulation of a already atherosclerotic aorta, prolonged CPP time, use of an IOBP. Again, in the post-operative period, again, major risk factors, atrial fibrillation and low cardiac output syndromes. Coming to the incidence of neurological complication in cardiac surgery, not specifically for CABGs, but most cardiac surgeries, is one is brachial plexus injury. It accounts to around 2 to 15%. Now, it could be because of the positioning, or the other thing is that when they do a midline sternotomy and spread the sternum across, it causes compression and stretching across the brachial plexus, especially when there is a lima harvesting that is being done. So now coming to the incidence of stroke, which is one of the outcomes in today's study, that is around 0.4 to 6%. Ophthalmic complications, clinically evident ones, is around 0.1 to 25% with various studies and centers. But then whenever we see patients who have undergone fluorescein angiography for ophthalmic, they have found that there is a microretinal embolus in almost 100% of the patients undergoing CPB. Delirium, around 3 to 32%. Subtle neuropsychological changes, even up to 70 to 80% of the patients do have it, which are usually transient and not easily noticeable. Intracranial hemorrhages are rare, but that is generally due to an ischemic stroke and a bleed into the ischemic area. And the other complication is again seizures, which account to around 0.6%. Now, like in general surgical cases, with advancing age, post-operative cognitive dysfunction is also a serious concern. It is found that in even in general surgical cases, around 26% of the patients in post-operative period in age groups above 65. Are known to have post-operative cognitive dysfunction, at least in the first week. And around 10% will still have persistent ones around till 3 weeks, 3 months, sorry. And it's known to be persist up to around 5 years. Now, factors which affect it is again, duration of anesthesia, the hematocrit values intraoperatively, age, which is a significant factor, pre-existing any Alzheimer's or neurodegenerative diseases, or even poor education has been found to be a significant risk factors for development of postoperative cognitive dysfunction. Coming to stroke, now around 40% of strokes occur during the intraoperative period, and most of the remaining strokes occur during the first 48 hours postoperatively. So if we monitor this, we would be having a higher statistics, because most of our patients remain intubated for a few hours just to monitor bleed and hemodynamic stability. We wouldn't notice that the ones which are especially like transient ischemic attacks, which might not even last 24 hours. And perioperative strokes have a mortality of almost 10 folds compared to patients without a perioperative stroke. Now, the commonest mechanism by which stroke happens, post-CABG patients is again embolism. That is around 75%. And sudden, like it is due to the sudden changes in hemodynamics, or manipulation of the aorta, especially the ascending aorta, like when they do a cross clamping, cannulation, or proximal grafting. Even a complex plaque which is in the ascending aorta can send out debris causing the embolic events. And around 13% is due to small vessel diseases, around 5% due to large artery stenosis, including the carotid. Another significant factor is atrial arrhythmias, like fibrillation. Then studies have shown that a history of recent MI within the last 24 hours prior to CABG is associated with almost 3 times increased risk of stroke. Now, coming to NARS per se, NARS was initially designed with an idea that it should be a non-invasive monitoring of oxygen supply and demand, primarily for cerebral. So it was first described back in 1970s, and it was based on the Beer-Lambert's law, similar to the one that is used in pulse oximetry also. But there is a slight difference in the way it works. Initially, it was called for the NARS for the brain, it was called the cerebral oximetry. Now, usually what Beer-Lambert's law describes is when a light goes through a medium, there is a large percentage of it that gets absorbed by the tissue, which is chromatophores, which is molecules which are colored, like say melanin, water, even blood, hemoglobin, bilirubin. These kind of molecules can absorb these waves. And depending on how much or the concentration of these molecules, the degree of absorption, reflection, scattering varies. And the thickness of the tissue through which it passes through. Now, NARS here takes advantage of what is called a biological spectroscopic window, wherein we have a wavelength, like visible wavelength do not usually penetrate well into tissue. So their absorption is high even in the skin level. So we do not have much of a role in monitoring using visible wavelength. So what they found is near infrared wavelengths, like range of 60 to 940, tend to have a better penetration into tissue, and we can use them for monitoring. So like for NARS in skull is possible because skull is generally translucent to infrared light. So the intensity of the reflected light actually depends on relative concentration of the colored molecules. In this case, we are using wavelengths which correspond to oxyhemoglobin and deoxyhemoglobin. So it is generally concentration of hemoglobin, oxygenated and deoxygenated. Now, unlike pulse oximetry, where we have a oxygenated arterial blood, which we're measuring, here predominantly we are measuring venous, especially in case of brain. Because cerebral volume, again, 75 to 85% is venous, and 15 to 25% is arterial. So it is generally a surrogate marker of cerebral venous saturation. The other thing is that the focal area underlying a tissue by measuring, like if we measure the wavelengths that we measure using pulse oximetry, generally 660-940. But here, because we are not using a detector which is perpendicularly opposite to the emission source, it's not a transmitted light. We want reflected light. So generally the wavelength they use is 730 and 810 nanometers. And that usually corresponds to deoxygenated hemoglobin, and it gives us an idea of the total hemoglobin concentration also. The other thing is usually the current devices have all specific proprietary algorithms to calculate this ratio and display cerebral, regional cerebral oxygenation oxygen saturation. Now, cerebral oximetry using NARS usually, like for all cardiac monitoring, output monitoring, have been validated using PA catheters. This is generally validated initially, at least, was using jugular venous oxygen saturations. So generally, the trends will correlate with this. The other one is that why it works well in cerebral is that there is not much of tissue overlying the brain. It is just skin and the skull. So especially this is important when we consider when we use it for somatic regional monitoring, where we have skin, adipose tissue and multiple layers, even visceral organs can come in the path of the light. Now coming to the probe or the array, it's called an optode. It consists of a emission probe, which is a light source, and high sensitivity multi-detector channels, which is usually 3 or 4. And it emits multiple wavelengths and detects at the space between the detector and the emitter is roughly around 30 millimeters to 40 millimeters. So this distance is required to for the light to go in a curve. Basically, light doesn't curve. It just goes into the tissue and gets reflected back onto the same side. Unlike in pulse oximetry, where it is transmitted through the tissue. And here what they do is called spatial resolution. So they resolve the light which is coming into a spatial plane, And what happens is that depending on the intensity of light getting hit on each part of the detector, that is like at 30 millimeters to 40 millimeters range, the intensity varies. So depending on that, they can plot a graph based on light intensity and source detector distance. And with that, they can estimate the amount of tissue through which this light is passing through and the saturation of the amount concentration of oxyhemoglobin and deoxyhemoglobin that is present there. Now, in this diagram, we can see the RSO2 is actually at the capillary level. So it's usually a mixed venous saturation, regional mixed venous saturation kind of value. And in this, we can see that light source is actually going into the skull, goes into the tissue to a depth of around 2.5 to 3 centimeters into the cortical tissue and takes a venous signal. It reflects back out of the light, which is entering the tissue. Only around 0.1 to 0.5 of the light, percent of the light actually reaches back to the detector. So it should be a very high sensitive detector to get an accurate value. And this machine is actually the newest Medtronic machine, the 7100. It has four probes, basically two cerebral and two somatic probes, which can also be used for all somatic. The other thing to keep in mind is that when NARS is used, it only gives at the capillary level. The major reason for that is the infrared radiation that is incident on a vessel which is more than 1 millimeter generally gets completely absorbed and doesn't reflect the signal back to the detector. So those signals are attenuated at the vessel level. So only vessels which are less than 1 millimeter actually gives out the signal. Now coming to the placement of the probe, there is a concept when it comes to the cerebral oximetry that is called the skin cortex distance. Basically in normal adults, it's around 10 millimeters, meaning to say the distance between the skin and the cortex. But studies have shown using MRI that in elderly, it increases by around 50%. So what happens here is the amount of brain volume through which the tissue, the light passes through actually significantly decreases. Normally it's around 1.5 centimeter square of area, centimeter cube of area. So, but then in this, it will be much less because there is only less tissue through which the light is going through. That is why this 30 millimeter separation or 40 millimeter separation between the emitter and the detector is quite important. Now coming to placement again in cerebral probes, we should be careful to avoid the frontal sinus. Because again, if you keep there is an air separation plus the distance between the skin to cortex increases. So the most manufacturers suggest that we place the probe around 3 centimeters above the supraciliary line with the long axis parallel to the intraoral line. And ideally, if you are supposed to cover the optodes with the opaque tape. Reason being, external light should not bleed into the system and contaminate the light which is coming from the emitter so that the values remain accurate. Now for spine, again, the spine surgery, so if you want to do spine monitoring, usually they're placed at T5 to T7 and L1 to L3. Now coming to a typical monitor display, this is taken from the Medtronic monitor. So first thing to remember is, prior to induction, once the patient is settled on the table, once the monitor set us, we are supposed to get a basal value. This will give a pre-induction or pre-intervention value. Ideally, all values should be compared to this. Now, generally speaking, the pre-induction value is around 65% for most cerebral, plus or minus 5, and that is considered normal. And left to right hemisphere asymmetry, like usually around 5% of the patient population have around 10% difference in between this. That is like if left is 65, the other one can be 75. Wild variations can occur, but that is only in 5% of the population. Now, when we are using it for a somatic monitoring, there is usually around 5 to 20% increase compared to a cerebral. This could be because there is a higher venous weightage in the brain compared to the somatic system, where it's more kind of more or less arterial and venous. Then, when do we take it as a warning signal? Generally speaking, most conservative studies use around 20% decrease from the baseline or an absolute value below 45 to 50. But there is no actually proven value through which we should take an intervention strategy. Some liberal studies say around 10% drop also, generally we should intervene. And like any other monitoring, it is important to monitor the trend rather than absolute value. So if we see a general, while surgeon is performing a procedure or while inducing, if we see a generalized trend in drop in all parameters or a global level, if it is decreasing, then it is a warning sign. Coming to the advantages of NARS, NARS provides a continuous, non-invasive, real-time information. So we know exactly when a procedure is happening, when the surgeon is near a vessel or any, especially in spine surgery, the drop in saturation corresponds to an action which is happening and it's real-time. So we have time to intervene before any permanent ischemia happens. The other thing is NARS is not dependent on pulsatility with like pulse oximetry. We don't measure the pulsatile component separately. And it maintains efficiency, especially during non-pulsatile flows, during CPBs and low flow states. Now coming to situations like cardiac arrest or DHCA, where only NARS would give us a value because there is no pulsatile flow in these conditions. So this is one of the ways to monitor a DHCA. Now, the other advantage is compared to other monitors, cerebral monitors like SSCP, MEP, we really don't have to modify our anesthetic plan for monitoring. Like in SSCP, we cannot use inhalational agents or muscle relaxant to interfere with the monitoring. So those things do not affect our, so NARS when we are using, it doesn't affect our anesthetic management. Now coming to the disadvantages, it can, like I told, other chromophores like bilirubin, methylene blue, even water molecules can interfere with the measurement, especially because they have an absorption spectrum within the 700,000 nanometer. Now, the other thing is large shifts in hemoglobin concentrations during CPB can actually influence this. Now, again, the path through which the light travels through is not easy to predict, especially when it comes to somatic, like where we can have liver. Even if our intended target is kidney, there can be any other organ, even intestine, bowel loops coming into the way. So a lot of errors can creep into, especially when we are using somatic, because we do not know the path the light is taking. Now, the other thing is when the concentration is of hemoglobin is very high, especially in CHDs with cyanotic and uncontrolled polycythemias, when the hematocrit is more than 60, generally gives an unreliable results. Now, another issue they have noticed is, especially in patients who have just expired, even in them, because the consumption of oxygen has also gone down compared to the supply, the relative ratio of saturation remains the same. So for some degree of time post patient has expired, he might still have a normal regional oxygen saturation. Now, coming to the study, there is a study which said that if we actually intervene based on the cerebral oximetry, number of events of incidence of stroke almost come down to zero, and there is around 60% decrease in AKIs, and much lesser RBC transfusions are done. Now, another study had found that there are various interventions that can be done to prevent the cerebral desaturation, like treat the hypotension, increase the FiO2, normalize the CPB flow, or decrease the CPB sweep rate so that carbon dioxide a little bit increases so that constrictions go off, then deepen the plane of anesthesia, these kind of interventions. So these kind of interventions have been found like to decrease around, they found that around 61% of the patients experience a cerebral desaturation event during the surgery. And usually if we intervene, we can mitigate the effects of disease desaturation and decrease the incidence of any adverse events. Now, in another article by Descamp, they have and colleagues, they have found that they have made a step-by-step protocol for intervening when there is a low there is a decrease in saturation, or when we notice a red flag sign of desaturation. So they have considered step-by-step approach, like first we decide whether it's a unilateral desaturation or a bilateral desaturation. First we check the neck position, we check the catheters are in place, whether it is occluding any major vessel. Then we check for the mean arterial pressures, then systemic saturation. Basically we try to increase the FiO2s. Then we see if the PaCO2s are very less. So we have to decrease the sweep rate, bring up the PaCO2s, prevent the constriction. Then if hemoglobin is less, we correct the hemoglobin. Then if there is any requirement of inotropes, and we'll also try to find out if there is any increased cerebral consumption, like in case of seizures, where there is an excessive consumption by the brain. So we try to give anticonvulsants, correct this. And if there is any raised ICP, we try to bring down the ICP. So these interventions have been formulated in a step-by-step manner, like in difficult airway algorithm. Like we have a step-by-step approach, so we don't miss out on things. So this is one intervention strategy which has been devised to help us follow through a desaturation event when we notice it on NIRS. Now, benefits of NIRS monitoring when combined with an intervention algorithm is that it reduces cerebral desaturation events, less AKIs, less incidence of stroke, less incidence of prolonged mechanical ventilation. Even the mechanical ventilation period is decreased, length of hospital stay is decreased, the rate of transfusions have come down. And now there are also derived parameters which have come up, like there is a parameter which has come up called tissue oxygenation reactivity index or TOX. So they have linked the cerebral oximetry value to MAP to identify whether the brain is actually having an autoregulatory feature that is still functional. This is especially useful in cases of neurosurgery and when it's associated when there is a cerebral edema. Now coming to the article per se. So this was published in actually JCBA back in December of 2020. It was a prospective observational single center cohort study. So it was conducted by Kamenskaya and colleagues in Russia. So their aim of the study was to evaluate the dynamics of cerebral oxygenation supply in patients aged around 65 and undergoing coronary artery bypass graft. Now, one thing to keep in mind is they have completely done under on-pump beating heart surgeries. Like we usually practice off-pump here, so that can affect the interpretation of this data. The other thing is the hypothesis is that like whether lowering the intraoperative cerebral desaturation events will result in lesser neurological complications. Now, coming to the material and methods, in April, the study was conducted from April 2018 to November 2019, and all are on-pump CABGs. They enrolled around 200 patients, age 65, which was taken as the mean age, and with coronary artery disease, scheduled for CABGs. The inclusion criteria was 65 years, primarily scheduled for only a CABG, and patients with more than 50% one-sided carotid stenosis were included. Exclusion criteria was again patient refusal, any presence of MI, stroke or TIA within the last 6 months. If there is bilateral stenosis or completely occluded artery on one side carotid, they were excluded the patient. Any emergency surgeries, hybrid surgeries or valvular surgeries again were excluded. Pre-existing psychiatric disorders or any neurodegenerative diseases or any patient with a mini mental scale score less than 30. Again, MMSE scale generally about 24 is considered normal and 19 to 23 is considered mild and 10 to 18 is considered moderate impairment and less than 9 is considered severe impairment. This is generally used to assess the cognitive impairment in patients. Now, coming to the measurement, they measured regional saturations on left and right hemispheres. They started it after the induction of anesthesia. Now, the thing to remember is generally we should take it prior to induction. If we start it after induction also, the machine would calibrate in the first 5 minutes. So the baseline value was post-induction. The other thing is 15 minutes after commencement of CPB, a minimum value of the least value that was obtained throughout the CPB procedure and at the end of CPB. Another one was 15 minutes after the CPB and at the end of surgery. So basically they had collected 6 values. Now, how they calculated the difference is basically the value at stage 3 minus the value at stage 1 divided by value of stage 1 multiplied by 100. Now, it was a blinded study where the performing anesthesiologists and professionals did not know what was the values obtained in NIRS. Coming to assessment of neurological status in the postoperative period, all patients prior to surgery also underwent neurological examination using the National Institute of Health Stroke Scale prior to surgery, 5 to 6 days postoperatively, and at the end of hospitalization period. It was all done by independent observers so that it didn't have a bias. Then encephalopathy after surgery was determined by a non-focal deficit, and it was usually temporary. And neuropsychometric tests using MMSE was done, as explained before. Stroke outcome was defined as focal neurological deficit persisting more than 24 hours in order to weed out TIA, which is less than 24 hours, and confirmed by an MRI and an EEG at the same time, at these stages. Mortality rate was taken from the hospital register. Coming to the statistical analysis, continuous variables were presented as means and standard deviation. Categorical data was presented as frequencies and percentages. A univariate logistic regression analysis was performed to as a determined risk factors for neurological complications, so that you can rule out any confounding factors, because we give one factor assumption of association, like that we can rule it out. The other one is odds ratio were reported as 95%, basically meaning to say p-value was taken significant when it was less than 0.05, and it's considered statistically significant. The results were neurological complication in the study group were observed in 20% of the cases. Encephalopathy accounted for 75% of the cases of neurological complications. 30%, around 30 patients were diagnosed with moderate, like there was post-hypoxic encephalopathy in 30 patients. According to MM scale, they were rated around 21, which is just mild cognitive impairment. Ischemic stroke were identified in 10 patients, which is significantly higher than the usual percentage of stroke that was found in similar surgeries. Risk of neurological complications were dependent on the extent of decrease in cerebral saturation in the left and right hemispheres. An increased risk was associated with around neurological complications were seen when there was more than 20% drop in regional saturations. And history of two or more MI and level of age-adjusted Charlson comorbidity index are also associated with increased neurological events. So basically meaning to say, if there was a history of MI or if the Charlson comorbidity index shows a higher value, it is higher incidence of neurological risk. Now, the limitation of the current study was that it was an observational study, so they did not have an intervention that was planned to correct the desaturation events. So we did not know whether just knowing that there was desaturation is good, just for documentation purpose. But if you really want to know whether knowing this, we can intervene and try to overcome this desaturation and prevent neurological deficits in the patient. So a prospective interventional study would have been better. Again, single center study. So we do not know the protocols they usually follow, the surgical competence, the anesthesiologist involved. So it might not actually reflect upon our center and how we can incorporate these things into our centers, especially given the fact that they generally do a beating heart CABGs on pump and we generally do off pump surgeries. And another major drawback is that the authors did not collect the data of preoperative NIRS. So we really do not know pre-induction NIRS values and what was the actual baseline for these patients. So they could bias our opinion. In conclusion, the present study demonstrates that in patients with CAD age 65 years, a decrease in cerebral oxygenation during CPB is in both left and right hemispheres were associated with an increased neurological complication. Risk increases with decrease in these indicators by 20% or more relative to the stage of anesthesia. If around 5-fold in left and 7-fold in right hemispheres basically, but this has not been found in any other study. History of previous two or more MI or a high level of age-adjusted Charlson comorbidity index is also associated with a risk of neurological complications. The incidence of stroke in the hospital period in these patients with CAD age more than 65 is higher compared to the results compared to other studies which have not given around 6%. Now, these are the references I have used for the study. Thank you.
Jess, that was an excellent presentation of the subject given to you. You started with impact of age on adverse cerebral outcomes and then went on to risk factors for adverse cerebral outcomes. Then you dealt with NIRS, the theoretical background. Then you actually went into the paper, which was published in December 2020. On the subject, 200 subjects were there in the group, and it was a prospective observational study looking into neurological outcomes with cerebral oximetry. And the topic is open for discussion. Anybody wants to ask any question, please unmute or put it on the chat box. The chat box, as of now, there is no question. In which case, I just want to make a couple of comments. Are you able to hear me?
Yes, sir.
One is, at one point you mentioned NIRS is a surrogate of cerebral venous oxygen saturation.
Yes, sir.
So, to my thinking, it is a cerebral capillary or tissue oxygen saturation, because
sir,
70% is venous blood.
Yes, sir.
And 30% is arterial blood. So arterial component is also there. So to my thinking, it's not exactly cerebral venous.
Sir, they mentioned it as actually regional mixed venous saturation.
Yeah, that's what I would think, that it is a 30-70 arterial and venous blood is present when you are at the tissue level. So anyway, that's a point to be debated. We will. Any other questions or comments? Dr. Prabhu Shankar is there, I think, and Dr. Anup is there. Anybody else?
Regarding the NIRS, it won't reflect certain areas. Now, what I suggest, I think jugular bulb, venous, mixed venous saturation. Hello, sir?
Yes.
Hello. It's because this one, it reflects, NIRS reflects only the regional, this one. Example, certain areas where, like watershed areas, it won't reflect the this one, sir, blood supply. Hello?
Yeah. When you do the cerebral oxygen, you are putting the pro sensor on the frontal area. And if posterior circulation is not monitored in a typical situation, so if you have four sensors, if you have four sensors, two you can put at the back and two in the front. Actually, two on either side, which was shown in the picture.
How do it differs from jugular mixed venous saturation?
Just can you ask that, answer that question? How does it differ from mixed jugular venous saturation?
That would give a more of a global idea, like sir has told. Like jugular would provide a global cerebral saturation point of view, but this would be only the frontal area. The other areas might be ischemic. It's not very representative of the entire brain. So when you take jugular, it would be much more accurate because we'll get a global idea of how the desaturation events have happened. But the issues, again, we'll have to put an invasive probe, risk of thrombosis, especially in a patient who was already having atherosclerotic changes. It would be a little difficult to have the jugular probe when we non-invasive monitor.
The jugular venous oxygen saturation.
Very easy to put.
No, it is easy. It's relatively easy. Only thing is the tip of the catheter
should be
accurately positioned in the jugular bulb. If it is not in the jugular bulb, it will not represent the mixed venous the cerebral jugular venous oximetry. And the other problem with jugular venous oximetry is that the contamination with the extracranial vasculature. So that has to be taken into account. And the other important difference is jugular venous oximetry needs constant flow of blood. So it is not applicable when the circulation is stopped. For example, in deep hypothermic circulatory arrest, it may not be precise. Whereas cerebral oximetry works if there is pulsatile flow or non-pulsatile, irrespective of that, it works. Anup Daniel, you want to make any comments?
It's a very good presentation. I agree there are a bit of fallacies are there when we are using nurse monitoring, but the biggest advantage of using nurse is that it's a non-invasive mode of monitoring the neuro. So in patients who are not particularly going for neurosurgical procedures, good modality by which we can monitor the cerebral circulation and cerebral function to an extent. And as the study has shown, in the nurse monitoring is associated with neurological complications. So it is a significant tool that we have without going for more invasive modalities. And it does give us a picture, a rough picture. Of course, it only gives us an indication. It's just like any other monitoring tool. It will only give us an indication that there is something wrong in the cerebral function or cerebral circulation. And it is our duty on how we react to that information that we get that is going to determine the outcome. Just because we monitor with nurse, we are not going to change the outcome of the patient. How we react to the information we get is what is going to determine outcome. So that is what tools like these.
Yes, it gives a it reflects as a caution regarding the if anything less than 10% of the basal value, so that intensely and if you manage, you can minimize the complications rather than
correct
though. What percentage of carotids, just for percentage, either go for endarterectomy or CABGs? What percentage of the blockade?
Jess, please answer that question. What percentage of blockage indicates endarterectomy, carotid endarterectomy? That is the question. Jess, are you listening?
What was the question again? I missed part of the question. What percentage?
No, what should be the degree of carotid stenosis for you to do the endarterectomy?
Sir, in the literature, hello, sir.
Yeah, come on.
So up to 70% of the single vessel you can go ahead if the patient is asymptomatic.
Yeah, to a large extent depends on the symptomatology. If the patient is symptomatic, you have to address it. If the patient is asymptomatic and has a critical block, then you have
address the lesion, then go for this one. Only thing, major issue is hypertension should not be present, sir.
Okay.
Because stenosis.
That's correct. My question is, how do you explain 10% stroke rate with cerebral oximetry? Why did they get 10% stroke, which is actually 2% in literature? Jess, is he there or is muted or gone?
Hello, sir. Yes, sir. I can hear you, sir.
Yeah, you can hear us. I just wanted to know why there is a 10% stroke rate despite using cerebral oximetry.
Sir, the thing is, they did not intervene even when they had a decrease in cerebral saturations. It was just an observational study. So they found that there was desaturation. They didn't intervene in it. The other thing, they have taken up patients, like general CABGs don't generally, it's not necessary that they have a carotid stenosis. In this, the inclusion criteria had patients who are already having 50% one-sided carotid occlusion. So that would have contributed to a higher degree of stroke in these patients, sir.
Plus, again, 16% had the carotid stenosis on one side more than 50%.
Yes, sir. So that would have made a significant factor to the incidence of stroke in these patients.
Tell me. No, the other thing is they had elderly patients who were 72 years, mean age is 72 years. Maybe that's one factor which tilted the balance towards having more stroke. And did the ethical committee allow them to let the saturation come down and do nothing? Anyway, that's what they say. That's what they did it, so we will not question it. Maybe the ethics committee said okay.
Sir, actually, they did not know the NIRS values while the surgery is being done. The anesthesiologist was blinded to the NIRS value.
Yeah, that's what they did. The ethics committee allow that. When you allow the saturation coming down less than 50, you don't do anything. Anyway, I will not go into the depths of that because that the protocol in the study is like that. And based on this study, would you like to use NRIS in CABG?
Yes, sir.
You will use it?
Provided I get to intervene based on my NRIS value.
No, no. Do you use it in your center?
Not routinely, sir.
Only patients.
No, based on the study, you are saying you will use it, but you are saying you will not. We don't use it routinely.
We have been not using it routinely, but then yes, sir. We it would be beneficial if we incorporate it into our system. We don't have around. We have around 8 tables. In that one table, we can use around, but we don't have so many monitors at present to use it in all cases, sir.
No, the thing is, if you go by the guidelines, its recommendation is class 2A or class 2B. There's no strong recommendation for routine sir, use.
Sir, that is because there was no actually studies have shown that there is no actual baseline cutoff to intervene. So once we establish a baseline to intervene, probably it would be getting a higher recommendation. As of now, still it's debatable at what point we should intervene into make an intervention when the saturation is coming down. So probably once we have a more studies which will validate these things, at what point we should...
No, my point of view is that you must have the baseline value before anesthetic induction.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
That is absolutely that necessary is the... for you to know what was the basal saturation.
Yes, sir.
And then only you give anesthesia.
Yes, sir.
And the second thing is the mean arterial pressure, the carbon dioxide tension, the hemoglobin concentration, cardiac output, all the factors which influence the NIRS.
Yes, sir.
You have to, whether NIRS is present or not, you must maintain it within the normal range.
Yes, sir.
You cannot allow cardiac output to drop. You cannot allow the hemoglobin to drop. You cannot have a low PCO2. And you have to maintain good oxygen saturation.
Yes,
if
sir.
You do all this, and your cannulation technique is good, there is no recommendation of class 1 in the recommendation for use of NIRS. Only thing is if you are doing aortic arch surgery with anti-grade cervical perfusion or you are doing deep hypothermic circulatory arrest for some reason, it is mandatory in those cases.
Yes, sir.
There it is really indicated. If you, in other cases, if you have the facility, you can use it, but there is no guideline recommendation. Do you agree with me, Dr. Anup and others who are present?
Yes, sir.
Dr. Chalam Kohli is there. Dr. Chalam Kohli? Dr. Parimala is there, I think. Parimala can answer. Anup, please tell me.
Yes, sir. The evidence base for the for this monitoring modality is just building up. So maybe in the future versions of the guidelines, the level of evidence might be better. But as we said, for routine CABGs may not be much useful unless we have a documented carotid stenosis or we are expecting a high-risk neurological outcome. In those patients, if we use these modalities, then it is good, of course. But we have to keep in mind that the other cardiac output, oxygenation parameters, all those parameters should also, whether we monitor NIRS or not, those parameters will also affect the cerebral saturation. So whether we monitor it or not, those parameters must definitely be maintained within the normal range. So that is the important. So desaturation NIRS monitoring may not actually be due a low blood supply to the brain, it might be a global phenomenon that is being reflected.
Yeah. No, if you have a facility and the money is not a constraint, you go and use it.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yeah. Anybody sir, wants to say anything else? Yes, sir.
Sir, just out of this one, sir, tea suffices a lot, sir, to prevent the CNS injuries, especially patients who are undergoing CABGs, especially older individual, to avoid the plaques or anything. For it reflects us rather than this, because the most commonest this one is the atherosclerotic emboli, plaques emboli. So what I feel, you can avoid the area or no touch clamp technique. So that will gives a lot when compared to this NIRS. What I feel, sir.
Yeah. Absolutely. Absolutely. You can use to look at the aorta and see the grading of atheromatous plaques and then decide about alternative techniques if the atherosclerotic grade is higher.
Because he said, as the age passes from 50 years, less than 0.5 to 4% or 7%.
It goes to 10% complication. 80 years old.
8 years. So that will... The most commonest cause, the single most commonest culprit is the this one, emboli, atherosclerotic emboli. What I feel?
Yes,
sir.
Yes, sir. Anybody wants to ask any questions? Any comments?
Hello, sir. Good evening, sir. I am Dr. V. Kumar from Delhi, sir.
Yes,
I have
sir.
One question. Please. Can I ask?
Yeah, absolutely.
Sir, if it is saturation in NIRS saturation is low, can we compare it with the venous saturation? Because we generally have CVP line during the from CABG. Can it be compared proportionately decreased than before intervention?
Actually, that's a great idea. According to me, it's a great idea. You're just seeing whether the desaturation is occurring in all parts of the body or only in brain. If you want to look at that, certainly you can look at these central venous oxygen saturation and the cerebral oxygen saturation. And if both are falling, maybe there is a fault in the systemic
oxygen
saturation, hemoglobin, cardiac output, etc. Vis-a-vis regional oxygen saturation decrease, it will not be reflected in the central venous oxygen saturation. That's a great idea, I would say.
So can I make a comment?
Absolutely. Come on. We are waiting for you.
Sorry, sir. I'm a little late. But when we had used NIRS for pulmonary endarterectomy cases,
Yes.
During DHCA, we don't have any other monitor for saturation, venous saturation or arterial saturation. So I feel that it is useful, but we also need to act immediately, as the other person said previously. Once getting to know that there is a fall, how much we can help the patient. Patient is in circulatory arrest, surgeon cannot do it faster, but there is a fall in NIRS value. So whatever suggestions we have, how can we correct that at that moment? And we saw that one or two patients had neurological damage post-operatively.
In PT, it's a matter of simple matter. The reperfusion has to be started. If there is a 20% decrease in the saturation, cerebral oxygen saturation,
yes, sir,
you must inform the surgeon and request him to restart the circulation for 3-4 minutes. And once the oxygen saturation, the brain oxygen saturation comes back to about 70 or 80 or 80 maybe, again they can re-arrest and then complete the job. So this is what we do normally in our center. We use NIRS for PTE. Go on circulatory arrest. Usually the surgeon takes about 10 to 15 minutes of circulatory arrest time. for clearing one portion. Actually, as many as 3 or 4 circulatory arrest times of 10 to 15 minutes are needed. So in between, you reperfuse it, and then again go back to circulatory arrest, and then continue the procedure. That's
what. Okay, thank you. That
happened. That is easy in PT, but if the circulation cannot be re-established because you are doing a procedure where you cannot get the blood in the circulatory field, that there it becomes little difficult. But you must inform the surgeon. If there's a desaturation, you must inform the surgeon and let him decide what he wants to do.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Robert, the partial circulation in that conditions.
You mean low flow?
Low flow.
Low flow can be done, but in PTE, because of the bronchial collaterals, lungs will be, the surgical field will have blood coming and flooding, they will visualization will be poor. So you have to arrest the circulation.
One of our people do low flow technique also, sir.
No, it will not be for PT, it will be for something else. Any more comments or questions? Very interesting discussion. I mean the presentation and all. And I'm told that they did the bypass on beating heart when on cardiopulmonary bypass.
Yes.
Isn't it?
Yes, sir.
That a beating heart.
Beating heart with CTV.
Thank you very much. We'll see you on Sunday at 9 a.m. Please log in by 8:45. And thank you very much for joining us.
I thank for Josh for his excellent presentation and more elaboration regarding the NIRS and various other studies. Thank you, Josh.
No, the introduction was good. He first
thank you, sir.
Impact of age. Then risk factors, then NIRS. That's good. That's a good introduction. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you, everyone who attended the session.